Morning. Hold on for a second. I log into a remote system. Clear this. All right. So I'm going to try and explain Azure Linux once more, and this time I'll leave out some non-essential bits and in place give some more practical examples and some more practical guidance. It's not fully comprehensive what I'm about to show, but on the other hand it is a pretty decent picture. So without further ado, let's get started. So why SE Linux? What was wrong with what we had basically before? So there's one thing that we basically back in the old days just didn't realize for some reason, and that is the fact that man is flawed, or woman is flawed, where men and women are flawed. Basically people make mistakes, whether that's on intent, they do things that they shouldn't do on intent, or they just make mistakes when they're, for example, tired, or they are preoccupied, stuff like that. So that's basically the main thing. Man is flawed, and we need a way to actually deal with that fact of life. And so we need to contain the impact of the mistakes that men make in computer systems. And that's basically why we need secure operating systems. We need to be able to contain the effects of flaws by human beings. Whether those are due to a malicious intent or just harmless mistakes, so to speak. So that's an important thing to understand, that that is what it's all about containment results of the fact that man is flawed, that humans are flawed. That's basically the core of it. So all that stuff about malicious or not malicious, that's really not applicable or actually, yeah, it is applicable, but the fact, it's just, the point is just that man is flawed, and whether that's due to him being malicious or not, that's just besides the point. Anyway, so SE Linux is an optional additional security system that complements traditional Linux security. So it's optional / additional. So you don't have to enable it. And if you enable it, then it's an add-on to traditional Linux security. It complements it. And that's an important thing to understand, that by enabling it, you're not nullifying the traditional Linux security. It's still there with full effect. It's just an add-on security system, SE Linux. It's one of the actually many optional additional security systems that can be added onto the traditional Linux security model, so to speak. So basically, that's expanded. Let's expand that a little bit to make it more accurate, so to speak. So SE Linux is a identity-based, flexible / configurable mandatory access control system that complements traditional identity-based discretionary access control system. Now, the important thing to note in this sentence here is that both SE Linux as well as traditional Linux security are identity-based access control systems. That's important because the identity-based part of the story makes it is also how the stuff, how SLinx complements traditional Linux security. It's using identities to basically create a association between SELinux and traditional Linux security. So both are identity-based access control systems, whereas SELinux is a mandatory access control system and traditional Linux security is a discretionary access control system. And then on top of that, I also noted that SELinux is flexible and configurable. Now, it might actually be a good idea to not mention that here. It's mentioned later, so but to keep it more focused on the issues that I want to stress in this at this point, let's just remove it and just make it this. So this here you can actually see the difference. They're both identity based, but the SELinux is mandatory access control system, whereas traditional Linux security is discretionary access control system. And what that means, we'll get to that in a second. So what, again, to complement means to add on. So it doesn't replace, SELinux doesn't replace traditional Linux security. It adds it, it adds functionality on. Now, in practice, you should look at it just the other way around. It adds below. So what that's saying is that SELinux is located below traditional Linux security in the Linux security stack. So you need to look at it as a stack. And on top of the stack, you have traditional Linux security, which is the identity-based discretionary access control model. And then below there, you have the optional additional security systems, in this case SELinux, which is an identity-based mandatory access control system. So there's a stack there, and basically this is an important note because, well, when some access is requested, the security system starts at the top of the stack by checking whether that access should be allowed or not. So first it checks the traditional Linux security, identity-based discretionary access control model, and then if traditional Linux security accepts or allows some access, then also the secondary additional optional security system, in this case SELinux, is checked, and if SELinux also allows it, then access is granted, else access is denied. Now if traditional Linux security denies a particular access, then at that point it's all game over already, because there's no use in checking SELinux at that point because access is already denied at the top of the stack, and so no use in checking SELinux because, well, it's already denied. So that's an important concept to grasp, that the place of SELinux in the stack, and the stack in the first place, so that you know that it complements it, doesn't replace it, it adds security, it doesn't take away security in any way. So it's always good to have SELinux because it gives you the possibility of more security, and it in no way will it take away any security, never, because there's always still the traditional Linux security on top of the stack, and it's always there to fall back on. Anyways, so what's the default goal of SELinux? Well, by default, SELinux is there to enforce integrity. That's basically all it is by default. And it sounds like a simple goal, but how do you do that? How do you enforce integrity with the information that we already discussed here? The fact that man is flawed, we need it, we need some way to contain the damage that man can do, and then we need to have SELinux complement traditional Linux security, and then we needed to be able to enforce integrity. So let's then, to basically see that, let's just compare the two access control systems, traditional Linux security and Azure Linux, and see, let's take out the cherry pick the main properties of those two security systems and see how how Azure Linux complements traditional Linux security. So as said before, they're both identity-based access control systems. Azure Linux is mandatory, traditional Linux security is discretionary. So I trust that you already know discretionary access control, but yeah, I'll still be explaining it to you. So identity-based access control, what does that mean? Well, it means that basically identities define the access control model. So identities define traditional Linux security. What is traditional Linux security? Well, it's basically it all stands or falls with identities. And when you open a shell, for example, here I'm opening a shell, the first thing I see in the prompt is an identity, Dominic. This is my identity here. And that's there because it's an important part. It tells me who I am, who this is, and it just tells, it gives me a lot of information. And if I do an IDZ, which is the ID or an ID command, run the ID command, then I get a lot of information about my identity, about security information. So it's saying here the user identity is Dominic, and it's a user. This is the numerical version, 1000, and translated to Dominic. And the group ID is 1000, and it's Dominic. And then there's some other groups in there that are associated with Dominic. Now, if you look at these two, that's probably a good thing to just mention it. You see, UID is 1000 and GID is 1000, and then in parentheses the actual translation in human readable language, so to speak. So the UID field is actually what I would call a security attribute. So it's basically a field that's filled in with an actual value. It's a key value pair. And the key is actually, we refer to that in security terms as a security attribute. And the value, we actually refer to that as a security identifier. So actually you have, instead of key value pairs, you have security attribute, security identifiers, security identifier pairs. So that's basically terminology that I just want to make clear. So what you actually have here is the identities, and the identities are assigned to all the entities on the system. Now, entities can be either active entities or passive entities. So for example, to see the active entities on the system, you could do PSAUX, which shows you all of them. These are all the active entities on the system, and they all have identities. So here you have passive entities, or sorry, active entities with the identity of Dominic, and here you have them with the identity of root, here you have them with GDM, and so forth and so on, polkitd. They're all active entities, and to see these passive entities, or at least the file system passive entities, you can do lsrz, and here you have a bunch of passive entities, and they also have identities. It all has identities. Here you have passive entities with the root identity, and here you have passive entities with the Dominic identity, and so forth and so forth. So yeah, that's just an important concept, that a Linux system is all about entities, and eventually it's all passive entity, because everything is basically reflected on the system as a object. But you can subdivide that in active objects and passive objects, and I'll just refer to it as entities. so that you can basically so that it makes more sense. But because by saying object, you already basically implying that it's passive. But so let's from now on let's talk about entities when we're referring to resources, and active entities when we're referring to processes, and passive entities when we're referring to objects, to passive entities, resources that do not do anything, so to speak. So identities are associated with all resources, whether they're active entities or passive entities. It's basically the core of the traditional Linux security model. And on top of that, you have the permission bits, which are basically 3 bits assigned to the user security attribute, group security attribute, and the other security attribute, so to speak. And those bits allow you to specify whether users, groups, or others can read, write, or execute respectively. And the owner of the resource has actual discretion over how to set the bits. And so with that said, let's see where we are. So let's just compare traditional Linux security versus SE Linux. Now, so I explained a little bit about the core concept of traditional Linux security, about that it's identity based. Let's just go a little bit deeper in that. So SE Linux or traditional Linux security is decentralized and discretionary. So with the stuff that I just explained in mind, what does it mean when I say it's decentralized and discretionary? Well, it's discretionary because the owner of the entity has discretion over how to set the permission bits. And the permission bits govern how users, groups, and others can access the resource. So it's discretionary. It's the identity, the identity can basically specify how the security is set for resources owned or created by that identity. That's a discretionary property of that. So you trust the identity with the security over the objects that that identity owns. And then if you relate that to the fact fact that man is flawed, that humans are flawed, then basically you already have here the problem that basically you trust men to govern the security over resources that he owns. But you know that man is flawed. So that's basically a problem there. It's just a conflict there because, well, that's just not good. You know that he's going to make mistakes, but still you allow him to govern security over his objects and identity. So that's what I mean with the discretionary part. So how is it decentralized? Well, the discretionary access control security system is decentralized because, well, each identity has discretion over how security is governed for that identity's resources. So Dominic, so active entities with the identity of Dominic can govern the security properties of entities that are identified with the Dominic identity identifier and root. And the root in this case is a bit different example because root is a special user, but other identities can do the same for their for resources that they are associated with. So so many different identities have some part in the security. So there's no single entity that takes care of all the security. No, there's these different identities, and all these different identities have some discretion over the overall security of the system, so to speak. So that's why traditional Linux security is considered discretionary and decentralized. You trust all these identities with at least some security, and that makes it decentralized and discretionary. Now, whereas Azure Linux is actually centralized and mandatory. So, with Azure Linux, users do not, or sorry, entities and identities do not have any discretion by default over the security on the system. And I say by default because we could actually give users, or sorry, identities, entities, some discretion. But by default, it doesn't. And security policy is defined centralized. It's governed centralized. That means that you can have a single entity or a select specified set of entities govern the security. But it's not like traditional Linux security where each identity governs some security in the system. So it's centralized and mandatory, and the security policy is located in etc Azure Linux, but we get to that. But the point is that these identities don't have anything to say about the Azure Linux security decisions, so to speak. Whereas in traditional Linux security, they do. They have discretion over how security is governed for their resources. So it's centralized and it's mandatory. Identities don't have anything to say about it, and they don't have anything to say about it. And that makes it mandatory and centralized. And that's an important aspect, and that's an important thing to understand how Azure Linux complements traditional Linux security. And if you get that issue, if you really understand that, what it means, the centralized versus decentralized and the discretionary versus mandatory, then you also start to see the value of it all. But that's just half of the story. The other half of the story is that traditional Linux security is coarse-grained / access permissions. So what do I mean by that? So for example, if I create two processes. So my identity is Dominic, and I just create two scripts, for example, and each script I could just do it. nano tests one shell, and then just simple script. Bin shell. And then sleep r while 0. Well, I'm not sure if this is actual this is actually properly or proper. Probably not, because my bash isn't all that. Cmod plus x. Bad interpreter. Oh. And it's basically doing it. All right, and now let's do the same. Cat test one, and it's just stupid example test one shell. And this greater test two, or just the CP test one shell test two shell. So you have basically we have basically two scripts, two active entities on the system, and they both and let's just this is probably better. So from a traditional Linux security, this is basically the representation. So we have two scripts running, two active entities running on the system, and they both run with the same identity. So what that means is that script 2, test 2, could interfere with script test 1. And script test 1 could interfere with script test 2. Or could actually, interfere is probably a good way to put it. Because they both run with the same identities, so they both have full discretion over each other. And, well, that's pretty bad, because we don't particularly trust each of these processes to have that discretion over other processes on the system. But there's just no way for us to specify, okay, this process should not mess with that process, other than because they run with the same identity. And all these processes in this list run with the same identity. So they can all, from a traditional Linux security perspective, all mess with each other. And all these active entities also maintain passive entities. They many of them write files or maintain files. And some of those files have sensitive information in there. And that means that each active entity with a particular with the Dominic identity, entity with the Dominic identity, can basically manipulate files of other active identities active entities that also have the Dominic identity. So there's just, it's very coarse grained. Now you can actually do some isolation by using different user identities. So for example, if you look at, and I'll just foreground, peace out again. Now they're gone, I think. Anyway, so if you do ls all c home, and I'll don't do the Z's because that makes it a little bit more overly complicated. So here you have the home directories, and here you have, so the different home directories with different identities, and the permission bits are set that only the user identity has full access to the directory. So here you have actually some isolation where, for example, the user hello would not be able to access the user Gris home directory, because they both directories, both passive entities have different identities, and the bits are set that only the user has full access, and groups and others don't have access at all. So except for root, because root is the system user as well as a real user, it's a special super user, so to speak, they can't access each other's home directory. So the identities is basically the only thing that can be used to isolate processes to some extent. But you only have one super user, which is root. So if you need a process that has super user privileges, then you only have a single identity to use, and then there's no way to say, okay, this privileged process, this privileged active entity should not be able to mess with this other privileged active entity, because they're both root, they both have the root identity, so they can both mess with each other. And that sucks. A root can basically mess with everything in the system. So you want a way to actually contain individual entities, active entities, or better said, you want a way to be able to contain the access of active entities to individual passive entities, so that you can actually specify, okay, although this process has the same identity as this process, we still want to be able to isolate these processes. That's one aspect, and that's what S-Linux, that's how S-Linux complements traditional Linux security. But on top of that, S-Linux of traditional Linux security is also access, in the sense that each of these active entities with the Dominic identity have a fixed set of permissions, and these permissions are basically more permissions than the average active entity needs. So if I could, for example, rm slash dash rf and then period, and that'll allow me to remove all the file system objects in the current directory, which is my home directory. Because they're all owned with the Dominic identity, or at least most of them are owned by the Dominic identity. Some of them are owned by root, so I won't be able to remove those from a traditional security perspective. But that doesn't mean that each of these file system objects are actually owned by this actual process, and this actual process is just a bash shell process. So there could be, for example, a program running with the Dominic identity, which maintains a file in my home directory. And if I do in the shell, if my shell process does an rm-rf and then period, then it removes all the then it's able to remove all the files owned by by the Dominic identity, including files that are not actually files owned by this shell process, by this shell entity, but also files or objects maintained by, for example, the GNOME PTI helper active entity, because the same identity, because the active entity runs with the same identity. And so there's very little integrity. So if you would be able to basically specify what each active entity can do, regardless of its identity, and you can do that centralized, then you have a way to actually contain each individual active entity, contain the access of each individual active entity to each individual passive entity. So basically you associate, and that's how it's done, and I will get to that a little later, but basically what you do is associate some more security metadata. So what you see here, the identity here, and what you see here, the identities and the permission bits, is what's called security metadata, and that's associated to a particular entity, in this case to the Dominic directory passive entity. This security metadata is associated to it, and what you do with S-Linux is basically associate some more security metadata, and then you use security policy to specify how entities can interact or operate with other entities or on other entities with other security metadata. So for each entity has its own or could have its own security metadata. And yeah, that's maybe a little bit confusing at first, because we still don't have discussed how that actually works. But just keep that in mind, and it's really, really simple if you just make a note of this, just copy these notes, and then just read it over. I keep it as simple as possible, and just remember what I, if you basically know what I say when I say discretionary versus mandatory and fine-grained versus access permissions, then those, that information in relation to enforcing integrity, then I guess you should be able to figure it out. But this is basically all that it hangs on. We have this discretionary access control system, but we can't actually trust entities on the system because we know that entities are flawed. So we want to basically contain all these entities on the system. We want to contain the impact of damage that they can do on the system. And they, all these entities, from a traditional security perspective, all have access permissions. They all have more permissions than they strictly need to function. So we need a way to basically say, okay, this entity only needs this set of permissions, so just allow it only that, and don't allow it a full range of privileges when it only needs to do a particular thing, because the more you can do, the more it can go wrong. It's basically a known fact: the more functionality you have, the more functionality can break. So if you keep it to the minimum, least privilege, and that's also, yeah, so basically where I say for traditional Linux security, it's coarse-grained and access permissions, as Linux is fine-grained and least privilege. So we're keeping the privileges to a bare minimum, to exactly what a entity needs, rather than just give them the whole set of permissions. Here you have all the permissions, and that's fine, and then just do what you want to do. We're saying from, okay, what do you want to do? Okay, then you need these permissions only, so that you just don't trust the entity with all these permissions. You just say, okay, you need that, then you only get that. We don't trust you to basically to not abuse your permissions, so to speak. All right. So this is really important to understand, and really important that you can actually explain that in clear terms, because that's what it's all about in this chapter. It's all about making the case, explaining to someone why all this trouble, why do we do what we do, and if you can actually make that clear, then that's just a very important part. So now we discuss, as this is basically all it is in essence. We have this issue, we need to enforce integrity because man is flawed. We have this old security system that basically trusted man, and times change, we now realize we can't trust entities. So how do we complement that old security system to the new way with the knowledge that we have? How can we do that? And this is basically, from a large overview, what we need to do. And then later on we'll get into the details on how we're basically going to implement that. Anyway, so as in Linux is a mandatory access control system. But it's not the only mandatory access control system. There are plenty other mandatory access control systems around. So what makes SE Linux better than other mandatory access control systems? Because that's probably another question that you would get if you tried to sell SE Linux to your boss or to your supervisor. Then okay, then you say, then the supervisor says, okay, now I understand why we need a mandatory access control system on top of the discretionary access control system, because you made that clear to me. But then why should we use SE Linux over, for example, Trusted Solaris or any other optional additional security system that Linux provides, because Linux provides or yeah, provides other additional optional security systems that you can use. Why should we use Azure Linux? And we get into that later, which other optional additional security systems I'm talking about. So why should we use Azure Linux? Well, there's basically two main reasons why we should do it. And I already noted that before, but I removed it, and this is basically the point where it's relevant. So Azure Linux is flexible. It's more flexible than other known mandatory access control systems. And the reason why Azure Linux is more flexible is because Azure Linux provides what's called many access factors. And, well, the term access factors should already explain what it means, but I still put it into quotes because it's also a technical term in Azure Linux world. And we're going to get to that next, but there's more, provides us many ways to govern security, so to speak. So that gives us flexible, because we have a lot of attributes at hand to specify whether an entity can do something or can be can do something on another entity or not. So that gives us a lot of flexibility there, because we have a lot of attributes to our disposal. And Azure Linux is also configurable, because it enables us to classify entities using security identifiers. So just like I discussed the security identifiers of traditional Linux security, whereas the identity, root in this case, or Dominic, those are identifiers. So we talked about these key value pairs, these attribute versus identifier pairs. So we can actually create identifiers on the system. If we do user add and then a username, identifier name, then we actually create a identifier on the system, a security identifier. And Azure Linux allows you to create security identifiers as well. So the administrator, the security admin, has this the power to configure Azure Linux by just creating new identifiers and associating those identifiers with entities. That's what makes Azure Linux configurable. And if you put the flexibility and the configurability together in practice, that means that you can just employ Azure Linux in any case, no matter what you want to achieve from a security perspective. Azure Linux is that flexible and that configurable that you can actually just implement the optimal solution. Just you don't want to overdo it, or you don't want to underdo it. And Azure Linux allows you to actually specifically target your problem, specifically deal with your problem. It allows you to make it really tight, but you can also make it not tight at all, but just target exactly what you need it to target. And that's all due to the flexibility. The access factors gives you the opportunity to make big use of all the attributes and the identifiers as well, but you don't actually need to use that all to the full extent. All right. So that's what Azure Linux has that other Mac systems tend to not have, or if they have some form of configurability and flexibility, then it's usually just not to the extent that Azure Linux has it. Azure Linux wants to give you that the full potential, the full power, but with power comes complexity and comes also complexity, I guess. At least when it comes to designing the security policy. Anyway, so this is just the first chapter. This basically is everything you need to make the case. And whether you can make a good case or not, this depends on how well you can explain these facts. But this is just what it all boils down to. But if you explain this, then of course there's going to be a lot of questions about, okay, sure, but how it does this work? How is it, how does it actually work? And actually I explained some of it from a traditional Linux perspective, but I didn't actually explain all of it from a Linux perspective, because here are, for example, the I talked about security metadata. Here's the Linux security metadata associated to, in this case, the what is it, slash home or slash slash home directory object passive entity. So this is the traditional Linux security metadata, what you see here in the first three columns, and then in the fourth column you'll see the SE Linux security metadata. And I didn't actually discuss it because, well, now that I show it to you, then you probably ask, okay, what is that? Well, how do I interpret those? And we'll get to that later. But just know that SE Linux is also all about associating security metadata with entities, just like traditional Linux security is. Alright, so identifying. So now we know the case, now we can make the case. Let's just make sure that we can actually identify as a Linux, and so that we can point to it and say, okay, that's as Linux, that's as Linux, and that's as Linux. So the as Linux is basically globally three components. You can basically divide them into three components. The most important component of SE Linux is basically the SE Linux, or sorry, the LSM-based SE Linux security framework. And basically, you could basically translate that to SE Linux in the kernel, Linux kernel. That's basically what this means. So that's the first and most important component, is SE Linux in the Linux kernel, aka the LSM-based SE Linux security framework. And the LSM abbreviation stands for Linux Security Modules. And what Linux Security Modules is it's a kernel system that enables or allows one to implement optional additional security systems. So SE Linux is an optional additional security system. You can basically use it to complement additional security. But it's not the only optional additional security system that you can choose to implement. There are others, and what LSM provides is it provides us with a way to actually specify which optional additional security system we want to add onto the traditional Linux security system. So that's what LSM does. That's all what it does. It's a system that allows us to basically choose which additional optional security system we want to use. And here we get into that. So the rationale behind LSM is to not favor one optional additional security system over another. So in the beginning there was just SE Linux, or at least when SE Linux was actually submitted on the Linux kernel mailing list, there was this question, okay, so you want us to adopt SE Linux in the Linux kernel, but how should we implement it? We don't want to make SE Linux the default. We want to provide flexibility. We want to give people the opportunity to choose another optional additional security system. And that's when LSM was basically conceived. And then later on, actually turns out that there was a need for that, because there are other additional optional security systems. For example, AppArmor, which actually probably was already, or now probably about around about the same time, I guess. This AppArmor is currently used in SUSE by default, I think, and maybe Ubuntu, not sure. So that's another optional additional security system. And you have Tomoyo, Yama, Seccomp, SMAC, and there might be others. And these are all additional optional security systems that are implemented via LSM. So you can basically use LSM to specify on build time and on runtime, or end or runtime, whether you want to use AppArmor or SE Linux. And you can't, in general, you can't use there all these additional optional security systems are mutually exclusive. So you can't use AppArmor and SE Linux at the same time. At least not currently. There is some work on the way, or at least some people are playing with the idea of using those additional security systems side by side. But currently, that's just not not allowed. And I'm actually not sure whether SecComp is implemented as a Linux security module. So SecComp, I'll just put that into parentheses, might not be an LSM-based security framework, a security system. So you might be able, and I think that's actually the case, because I'm actually on my system, SecComp is used next to SE Linux. So so if I reason and if I say okay, but each LSM-based security framework is mutually exclusive, then I would actually imply that SecComp cannot be used with SE Linux, and that's not the case. So I don't think SecComp is actually an LSM-based security system. But anyway, so you have all these different optional additional security systems implemented via LSM. And LSM allows you to basically specify on build time or runtime which security system to use. And how you do that in practice, I'm not going to go into that, but you're probably familiar with the kernel options when you build the kernel, and with the runtime options, the options that you specify on the kernel boot line, and then you'll probably be able to figure out how you can actually enable a particular optional additional security system. Alright, so that's that. So we're still talking about the LSM based SE Linux security framework, aka SE Linux in the kernel. So if we basically subdivide SE Linux in the kernel into, we can basically subdivide them into three elements. So let's discuss the three elements of the LSM based SE Linux security framework architecture. And again, we're going to get into some terminology that might at this point not be fully clear, but hopefully later on it all starts to make sense. The aim is at least to eventually touch on all the terminology that I use. So the first element of the LSM based SE Linux security framework architecture is the SE Linux, or sorry, the security server, the SE Linux security server. What it does is it maintains something that's called a security context. We briefly touched on the notion of security metadata, and those are called security context. But for now, I put them into quotes. We'll get into the terminology term security context later. But for now, just think about security context as security metadata. So the security server maintains security metadata and computes access decisions. So it computes whether something can actually do something or not using that security metadata. And then it provides those security policy decisions to what's called object managers. And those are also in quotes, because that's also a term that we're getting into later. But basically what it does is, so it's taking that security metadata from those entities, and it basically compares it, and then takes the policy, and then computes and says, okay, whether that access should be allowed. And then it basically forwards that decision to object managers, and that allows object managers to remain independent of the specific security policy that is used. And how that is relevant, we'll get into that later or not. But just make a quick note that that is what permits object managers to remain independent of the specific security policy that is used. I could briefly explain it. So object managers, and we'll get into that a little later. Object managers is a generic thing, so to speak. There could be many object managers on a system, as Linux has a kernel object manager, but there could be other object managers. You could, for example, implement an object manager in your application, and then that object manager could be designated your application's object manager, and then it could be, you could actually code that to be an extension to Azure Linux, so then the security server would basically forward the access decisions with regard to the objects that your object manager maintains to your object manager, to your app's object manager, and then your object manager can do its thing. And what that is, we'll get into that later. Anyway, so the second element of the LSM-based Azure Linux security framework architecture is an access vector cache. An access vector cache stores access decisions, computations provided by the security server for subsequent use by object managers. So I already explained that the security server basically maintains the security metadata and computes access decisions and then forwards that to object managers. And what the access vector cache does is basically it stores those access decisions so that object managers can hit the cache instead of going to the security server and ask the security server to compute it again, because it was recently, if the access decision was recently computed, then if you store it in the access cache, and it then it allows you, or it allows, yeah, you can, the object manager can hit the access vector cache, then that speeds up stuff and it reduces overhead. So that's why stuff gets cached, the access decision computations get cached into the access vector cache, so that the object managers can hit the cache first, and if the cache doesn't have it, then they can consult the security server for access decisions. Anyway, so what? So the kernel object manager. So here we have talked about object managers in general, but the third element in the LSM-based Azure Linux security framework is called a kernel object manager. And what it does is it manages, maintains a set of kernel resources and enforces policy decisions over those resources. And policy decisions are directly or indirectly obtained from security servers. So if a policy decision is cached in the access vector cache, then the access vector cache is hit, of course, and the access decision or the policy decision is then get from the access vector cache directly, but indirectly it comes from the security server, of course. And so kernel object manager maintains a set of kernel resources, whereas another object manager, for example, a DBus object manager, maintains a set of DBus resources, or a database object manager maintains a set of database resources. So we had the Azure Linux kernel object manager maintains a set of kernel resources and enforces policy decisions. So it gets policy decisions from the security server, either directly or indirectly. And then what kernel object manager does, it enforces it. It actually well, actually grants or denies access based on the security decisions, the computations. And that's basically the whole kit and caboodle, or the whole shebang. So that's with regard to LSM-based Azure Linux security framework, okay, yes, Azure Linux and kernel. And there's another small thing to note here, that another part of the of Azure Linux and kernel is that if you enable that, then a sudo file system will be mounted under generally SysFS Azure Linux, but on older systems it might be slash as Linux, and that sudo file system provides an interface to as Linux. So just like the slash proc files sudo file system provides an interface to the Linux kernel, for example to proc, you can read proc information or mem info information and stuff like that. The /sys/fs/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash/slash use that to query as Linux or to talk to as Linux to give it instructions. And that thingy will show up once you actually load policy, once you actually enable as Linux. So the second element or the second component in as Linux is what's called user space. And basically what that is those are just tools and libraries that complement as Linux in the kernel, or aka the LSM based as Linux security framework. So just tools and libraries, or actually tools, libraries and utilities, but tools and utilities probably the same. You could probably see that as the same. So let's just discuss that on a high level, I guess. I'm not going to discuss each and every utility, but some of them, or at least some sections of them. So, for example, policy compilation tools are part of the user space. And those tools perform the conversion of the text-based as Linux policy language into the format that the LSM-based as Linux security framework uses for enforcement. So the kernel, as Linux in the kernel, uses a binary representation of security policy, but you can't expect the as Linux administrators to write it in binary. So what you get is the humans, the as Linux administrators write the policy in human readable as Linux policy language, and then the policy compilation tools convert that into the binary format that is used by as Linux in the kernel to enforce. So that's what policy compilation tools do. Now the policy management tools basically enable us to install, remove, and update as Linux policies on running systems. The policy development tools aid in the creation and updating of as Linux policy. And the libraries, this is also a reasonably important aspect, are for applications that must be aware of as Linux or that enforce access control decisions using as Linux. We now know what that means, because we know that object managers enforce access control decisions over a particular set of resources. So if you have object managers in the user space, then those object managers will use the user space libraries for that functionality. So with or enforce access control decisions using as Linux, we just basically mean object managers, user space object managers. So it's basically libraries are for applications that must be aware of as Linux or that are applications that are user space object managers. That's basically what it's saying. Now hopefully that might not make sense at this point, but at least I'm pretty clear about that, about the facts. And then you finally have the utilities, which are used for working with and administration of as Linux enabled systems. And that's the user space, a component, the second component of the three components. And then you have the last component, which is the security policy, which is basically the law book, the book of law. And that is that's basically configuration data. So that's what it is. And that's stored on ETC as Linux and that's also /etc is the location of configuration data. But that's just all security policy is, it's configuration data. Alright, so the third chapter is about what's called security models. So what are security models? Well, you could look up what a model is in on Wikipedia. I tried that, and well, the descriptions there are so super technical. Computer architectural models and what they are, and then you get a full page of all kinds of descriptions. And I tried to simplify it, but a security model is a way for SE Linux to address a security challenge. That's basically my interpretation of the security model. So there are some default security challenges that SE Linux needs to address. And we touched on the main security challenge that SE Linux addresses already in the first chapter, which is to enforce integrity. So that's what SE Linux does, so that's the main challenge that it has. And how do you enforce integrity? So how, what's the security model for that? Well, the idea is to type entities. So to assign types to entities, and then enforce policy that governs how entity types can interact or operate. And that's basically, in a nutshell, all it is. You basically associate types or type identifiers to entities, and then you have this policy that governs how each entity type identifier can interact with other entity type identifiers on the system, security identifiers, interact or operate, because every entity has a type identifier. So then you'll have the flexibility and you can create those identifiers, as I also mentioned already. As an administrator, you can create identifiers and associate them to entities, as many as you'd like in theory. And then you can use those identifiers to specify how each type identifier can interact or operate with another type identifier. And that's basically what type enforcement is. But to implement that simple thingy, you'll have to basically deal with prerequisites. So one of those prerequisites is that we need to actually complement traditional Linux security. That's also discussed. That's one of the things that we discussed. We want to complement it. We want to add it on. We want to add on the functionality of enforcing mandatory integrity. And for that, we use a security model called identity-based access control. Because we know that the traditional Linux security is defined by identities. It's all evolved around identities. So if you want to basically complement that, you want to basically complement the existing traditional Linux security, then the way to do that is to actually implement identities ourselves, so that we can associate our identities to the identities of traditional Linux security. And then we have actually a way to complement it. Then we have actually the way to associate the two. And that's basically what the challenge that identity-based access control addresses. Basically, it's saying, okay, traditional Linux security has identities, and we need to associate the traditional Linux security. So we do that by creating identities as Linux identities as well, and then associating the as Linux identities to the traditional Linux security identities. And then we have a way to associate, a way to map, a way to bridge between the two security systems. And that's what identity-based access control really does. It's just a way to create a bridge between traditional Linux security and SLinux security. So we're associating SLinux identities to Linux identities using SLinux identity identifiers and traditional Linux security identifiers. So that's another, that's a prerequisite for type enforcement. Because yeah, well, it all evolves around type enforcement by default. But yeah, to be able to implement that, we need to actually establish a association, and to do that, we're implementing the IBAC security model. But we have other prerequisites. For example, we need to be able to allow specified active entities to manually change types. So we need to basically be able to allow an entity process, and yeah, an active entity to actually change types. So, and that in practice, because if a process is stuck to a single type, then it's stuck to a single set of permissions associated with that type. But if you can basically allow the administrator to associate various types to a particular entity, and thus to a particular identity on the system, then we can basically allow the administrator to give a user, that's what it boils down to, access to particular types, so that the user can actually switch permissions, so to speak, because each type has permissions associated to it, type identifier. So that basically allows us to implement what's called role-based access control. And what I mean is that, so each type has a set of permissions associated to it, which are least privileged in SLinux world, because we already discussed that that's what SLinux is aiming to do, to only provide the permissions needed for a specific task, for a specific entity. But if you have, for example, a active entity that has specific different tasks, then you want to actually be able to allow the administrator to grant access to different types to an entity, so that the entity has the discretion or not. You could also, you can also basically automatically type transition from one set of permissions to another, but you can also grant the entity permission to manually change from one set of permissions to another. So that's how SLinux implements role-based access control. I'm not sure if you're familiar with role-based access control, but it's basically access control based on roles. And in SLinux world, it all evolves around type enforcement. And role-based access control is a way to basically assign sets of permissions to entities. Not just one set of permissions, but different sets of permissions, if you want to. So let's just enables us to allow specified active entities to manually change specified types, type identifiers, or to automatically type transition. And that's called role-based access control in SLinux world. And we do that by associating SLinux roles with SLinux identities and SLinux types. So what we're doing is we're associating the roles to the SLinux identities and to the SLinux types. And the SLinux identities are associated to Linux identities. So if you put that all together, then basically what you get is that eventually SLinux types are associated to Linux identities. Because that's what it does, because SLinux identities associate to Linux identities, and roles roles identified associated to as Linux identities and to as Linux types. So the roles establish a bridge between types and as Linux types and as Linux identities, and as Linux identities establish a bridge between Linux identities and as Linux roles. That's how it's done. So it's all association, and it's all the main goal is to enforce integrity, but we want to do so in a way that we achieve all our security goals, and our security goals is to complement traditional Linux security and to also allow entities to be able to allow entities access to sets of permissions, different sets of permissions using different types. So identity-based access control and role-based access control make it possible for us to associate as Linux types with Linux identities eventually. That's basically what those two prerequisites with IBAC and role-based access control prerequisite security models do. Eventually it's all about just associating types with Linux identities, using as Linux identities and as Linux roles. And so it might seem complex if you read it, but if you think about it, it's really just pretty much genius how simple that can be, how simple you can actually complement Linux security by just using those models. It's just really ingenious, and it's really as simple as possible. Sure, there are some things to understand, how all is associated, how these identities, what's roles, what's types, and how do we associate, and what are they, why are they there? But if you get this over this hurdle here, then you have the main idea. But we still have some ways to go. So let's talk about labeling. So labeling is done to associate security metadata with entities, and I already discussed that. I already showed you that here's, for example, the security metadata for the Dominic directory in the /home/Dominic directory, whereas this is the security metadata from a traditional Linux security perspective, and this is the security metadata from the as Linux security perspective here. And that security metadata is used by the security server to compute access decisions. But if you think about security, then there's always some interaction or operation. You always hear me talk about entities, passive entities and active entities, and you always hear me talk about operations or interactions, because it's always about two parties, at least two parties in an interaction or an operation, where at least one party is an active entity, because to do something you need to be active, and the second party is either active entity or passive entity. That depends on whether you, for example, talk to another person or eat food. Food is, for example, a passive entity, because food doesn't do anything usually if it's dead. But if you talk to another person, then you're interacting with another active entity, and you're operating on food because food is dead. Food doesn't interact back, so to speak. So yeah, that from a security perspective, always think in active and passive entities, and always think in operation versus interaction. And because that's what security is all about. Security is all about managing interaction or operation. All right, so associating security metadata with entities. So all these entities on the system, they all have security metadata. Everything has its label. And it's important that those labels are correct, because if you classify an entity wrong, then you'll get unexpected access decisions computed by the security server. So yeah, that's need to make sure that labeling is all right. And so if you have some access violation, then the first thing you should check is, okay, is that are those entities in this event actually classified properly? Are those do those entities have the proper security metadata associated with it? Because there could be ways that, and we call that mislabeling, there could be ways that entities have wrong or suboptimal security metadata associated with it. So that's the first thing you need to check. But we'll get to that later in the troubleshoot chapter. But so, of vital importance, security metadata associated with entities. So that's what we call that security metadata, we call those security contexts. And security contexts are basically combinations of security attributes delimited by semicolons. So let's look at some of these SELINK security metadata. And here you have it. You have this security context here. And that security context is basically a combination of security attributes delimited by semicolons. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4 security attributes here delimited by semicolons. And all each of these security attributes are filled in with identifiers. So what you actually see between those columns are identifiers, but those fields themselves are the attributes. So the same as when I explain to you the user and group, you should look at them as key value pairs. So the key is the attribute and the value is the identifier. So for example, the you could consider the key for this field, you could call that the IBAC security attribute. But what's actually filled in, what you actually see, is actually the identity identifier. So you have the identity security attribute is the key, and the value is the identity identifier, security identifier. And the same goes for the role. The key is the role security attribute, and the value is the role security identifier. So key value pairs. And all these key value pairs are basically combined into a security context tuple. If you're familiar with the term tuple, it's used in database terminology and other aspects as well, other parts in the system as well. But it's just basically combinations of security attributes into a single security context. Now, you'll see here a fourth security attribute slash security identifier, and we're not going to deal with that in this section because it's associated to an optional security model that we didn't discuss here to simplify stuff. So focus on the three first security attributes. Alright, so security attributes are used to associate security identifiers with entities, not to entities. And I just explained it to you, key value pairs, just like identities with traditional Linux security. You have the user attribute, and it's filled in with the root identifier. And you have the group security attribute filled in with the root security identifier. And the same goes for this, the identity security attribute filled in with the system view identity identifier. The role security attribute filled in with the object underscore R role security identifier. And then the quota underscore DB underscore T security identifier associated with the type security attribute. Alright, so let's go to that deeper. So here we have a graphical representation of that. So you have these security attributes delimited by colons. So we have three in this example because we are only dealing with IBAC, rollback, and type enforcement, because those are the default security models, the default, what SELINK does by default. It can be extended as well, but we'll not get into that. And then basically these security attributes associate to identifiers. So the attributes are used to fill with identifiers, and those are the identity identifier is filled into the identity security attribute, the role identifier is filled into the role security attribute, and the type identifier is filled into the type identity attribute. And those attributes associate to the security models, so type enforcement, and roles associate to role-based access control, and the identities associate with identity-based access control. So that's how security contexts associate to security models. And it's all done simply for one thing, to enforce integrity. That's all, it all boils down. What you want to do is complement traditional Linux security with mandatory integrity, and this is how you implement it. These are the technical details about it, how you actually make it happen. So access decisions are computed by the security server using combinations of security contexts of sources and targets in interactions and operations. So I already told you that it's all about interaction or operation when it comes to security. And you always have more than a single party in an interaction or operation, and could be in at least there's always at least one active entity, because there's always some source doing something to a target. But there could be another active entity, or it might be operating on a passive entity. For example, a active entity called Dominic might operate on a file called Dominic period text, or an active entity called Dominic might talk to another active entity called Joe. That's an interaction as opposed to an operation. So get that right. If you get that right and you be clear about that, active entities, passive entities, operations versus interactions, sources and targets, and associate that with security, then you'll get the big picture. All right, so I already mentioned that as well. Ensure that labeling is correct, because if you associate wrong security metadata with entities, then the security server is going to compute wrong access decisions. Because the entities are not classified properly, so ensure that labeling is correct. So how is stuff labeled? That's another question you would ask, of course. If you say, okay, labeling must be correct, then okay, how can I influence that? How can I do, how can I make sure that that's right? So there's a couple of ways to label entities. The first way is to label entities with using as Linux policy language. And as Linux policy language provides us with some rules that allows that enables us to instruct as Linux how to label specified entities. So you can actually write rules that tell as Linux, okay, label that entity that, and label that entity that. And those rules are called type transition rules. We get into that later. By default, well, we'll just get into that later. Just know that the as Linux policy language allows us to specify rules that allow us to instruct as Linux to how to label specified entities, how to which security metadata to associate with specified entities. Then we have what's called the second way to label is security context specifications, and that's basically a list with entity and security context specification combinations. And that list specifies on a system-wide level how specified entities should be labeled. And this usually only applies to passive entities in general. So the security context specification usually only applies to passive entities and not to active entities, although there are some border cases where you might specify what you could consider a security context specification for an active entity. But we don't get into that now. But just know that security context specifications are basically a used list with combinations of entity, specified entity versus security context specification. So that the system can basically look into the list and say, okay, slash etc should be labeled with this security metadata according to the list. And that's basically used for fallback or failover, so to speak. So that that SLinux always has a way to look back and say, okay, is that correct? Is that also according to the specifications? So the third way to label is using library functions. And we also already discussed library functions in the user space chapter, where it's actually used for applications that must be aware of SELinux or actually used by user space object managers. But library functions provide functions that allow entities to manually change security context of entities. So you could use functions, or there are actually utilities that employ those functions that allow you to manually change the security metadata of an entity. Of course, the policy must allow that, so you can't, just because you have access to that function doesn't mean that you can just change security metadata of entities. You can do it from a technical perspective, but the security policy is basically governing whether you actually are allowed to do it. So that's an important thing to understand. But you could allow an application to do that, or for a particular set of identifiers. You can basically say, okay, this application can change from this identifier to that identifier only. And then that application can use that function to actually do it. So that's, and then the last way to label is what's called initial security identifiers. And this is basically a, initial security identifiers are basically hard-coded security identifiers used by SELinux for system initialization, predefined resources, and fail-safe. So if you think about system initialization, so you basically, that's basically starting up a system. So you boot up the system, and at some point in the boot process, the security policy gets loaded into the kernel. And then the entities are getting associated with the security metadata. But what happens to the processes that run before the policy is loaded? For example, the kernel threads. If you basically boot up a Linux system, then the first thing you see is those Linux kernel threads. And those are there even before init loads, or usually init loads the policy. So just to make sure that those kernel threads are classified properly, these initial SIDs are used, and in this case the kernel initial SID is used to associate that to the kernel threads. And that allows us to make sure that it's labeled properly, even though it's actually those threads were actually there before the policy was loaded. We were still able to make sure that it's classified properly because we associated those initial security identifiers, in this case the kernel initial security identifier, to a type security identifier called kernel underscore t. So before the policy was loaded, SELinux just assigned the kernel security identifier, initial security identifier, which is hard-coded into SELinux, and then the policy got loaded, and then SELinux basically replaced the kernel initial security identifier with the actual type security identifier that was specified in the policy. That's how stuff got labeled properly. And that's just all, that's just the only thing that's important. You just want to make sure that entities are created before the policy is loaded, or that they are associated with properly proper security metadata. that's this all that's important, because there's no policy enforce if the policy isn't loaded. We just want to make sure that that stuff is classified properly. So that's what we mean with using initial SIDs or hard-coded securely identified user method as links for system initialization. And they also have predefined resources. And that's basically predefined resources. Basically, for example, actually look it up as the info initial SIDs. You have the kernel initial SID here all the way below. So I would argue that security is a initial SID used for predefined resources. So security initial SID is basically associated with the /fs/sys/slash/slinux sudo file system. /lz/sys/fs/slinux. You see that the security T_T type identifier is associated with objects here, at least all most of them. Here's also one null device. And this what you see here is the actual identifier, but the security _T security identifier is actually associated with the security initial SID, which is used for predefined resources, because that's what it is. /sys/sys/fs/slinux is actually a predefined resource. So just to make sure that that's properly labeled, we use initial SIDs. And then you have failsafe. This is the final reason why initial SIDs are used. Failsafe. So, and that's also the most applicable for us. Basically, failsafe. What if something happens? For example, let's say you have a policy loaded in the system that declares some type identifiers, and you have a process that actually associated with a type identifier. And at some point, you just on a running system, you just decide, okay, I'm going to remove that policy, and thereby you're removing that type identifier, which is actually currently in use by a entity, by a process, because a process is associated with a type, but you're removing the type. So what happens? Well, what happens to that process, to the security metadata of that process? Because the type is no longer in the system. But what then happens is that SELinux basically notices that and says, okay, so this entity is associated to a string that's invalid, that type doesn't exist. So I'm going to replace that with the type identifier that is associated with the unlabeled initial SID, which is then, which is usually in the systems, the unlabeled _T type identifier. And that's basically how SELinux can make sure that there's no entities on the system that are classified with invalid identifiers. So SELinux just notices that. So the mechanism to actually make that happen is initial SIDs. They make sure that failover, that if there's a process with a identifier that's invalid, then SELinux can kick in and label that with a specified security identifier for invalid, for cases where in context has an invalid security identifier. And the same goes for example, if you have entities that have no security context at all. So for example, if I fdisk a new partition on a brand new hard drive, and I partition it with the ext4, whatever, format it with ext4, and basically I just mount it right under /mount, then at that point that new partition doesn't have any security metadata associated with it, because we haven't actually used any of the other three ways to label. So SELinux notices that and says, okay, this object, this entity, doesn't have any security metadata associated to it, so I'm going to kick in and associate the file initial security identifier to that entity, or to those entities. And that file initial security identifier is associated to and usually associated to the file underscore t type security identifier. So what you see then is you see context with file t. So if you see context with an object or an entity, usually an object with the type file t, then you know that that object doesn't have actually have a security context. It doesn't have security metadata, because the file t type identifier is associated with the file initial sit, and the file initial sit is associated to the object when as Linux notices that that object doesn't have any security metadata. So from an administrator perspective, be aware if you see entities with the unlabeled underscore t type or with the file underscore t type. Now that depends on the policy though, because the administrator could decide to associate a whole different type to the file initial sit or a whole different type to the unlabeled initial sit. But generally, policy that is based upon a reference policy, policy that is employed by most distributions, that type, the file underscore t type is associated with the file initial security identifier, and unlabeled underscore t type is associated with the unlabeled security identifier. Just like the kernel underscore t type is associated with the kernel initial sit, and stuff like that. So, but those are the two most important initial sits, the unlabeled and the file, because those are common. You commonly see people mounting new file systems that don't have security metadata, and then they come and they say, okay, this process doesn't have access to an object or an entity with that type identifier, file T. And then I have to explain, yeah, okay, that's because as Linux associates that type to that object when it notices that that object doesn't have any security metadata. So that's an important concept. Now, and then there's this last chapter, which goes into, actually we're not there yet. So then there's still the issue of persistent storage of labels. So as Linux can actually store security metadata persistently on file systems that support the security extended attribute. And it's using the security period as a Linux extended attribute name for that. So that's basically, if you have file systems that support the security extended attribute, and you have that support enabled in the kernel, then SELinux will actually store these that security metadata for the objects on those disks, on those partitions, on the disk itself. So you can actually pull out the disk and put it in another system, and it still has that same security metadata. So you don't have to actually make sure that it's labeled every time. Just the first time, if you create a new partition, and the first time you'll need to label it or take care of the labeling. And then once that's stored on the disk itself, on the partition itself, on the objects itself, using the security extended attributes, then you can just, you usually don't have to think about that again. So that's persistently storage of labels using the security extended attributes. And the file systems that support that, and that as Linux supports, you can also look at ammo. This command here, yeah, that's just commands for everything. FSUs, and then grab X attribute. So these are the file systems that currently support it. So we have setfs, squashfs, xfs, ocfs2, lustrfs, jfs, jfs, fs2. GPFS, DFS2, DFS, EXT4DEV, EXT4.3.2, ENCFS, and BTRFS. So those are the file systems known to the policy, at least, to support the security extended attributes. And this is actually a file context specification, or sorry, a security context specification that as it links to users to look up how a particular file system should be labeled. So what I said with a combination of a of a entity with a context specification with a with security metadata. So it looks it up and it says, okay, file systems of the ZFS type should be labeled with this security metadata, so that it knows if I see a file system of that type, of that type, then label it with that stuff. Security context specifications, the second way of labeling here, discussed here. And there are different lists of security context specifications. This is just a list for file systems that support extended attributes, but there are other lists. But I'm not going to go into those details, because that's actually managing SELinux, and this is actually just about the big picture. This video is just about the big picture, just to make sure that you understand the main things. Alright, so the last chapter is about policy language. So how do you actually talk with SELinux? How do you actually, what language do you use to actually speak with SELinux? So one of the main things we haven't touched on yet is what's called an access vector. It's a very important concept in SELinux world. Access vectors are provided to us by object managers. And access vectors are combinations of what's called security classes and access vector permissions. So an object manager actually classifies a entity in the sense, in a broad sense. Basically it adds a classification to an entity, and it has a set of specified permissions associated to that classification. And we can use that combination of classes and access vector permissions for our rules, for our policy. So this is not something that is configurable by us. We can actually specify identifiers and associate identifiers with entities, and then write rules how these entities can interact and operate, or operate. But we still have to deal with these access vectors, which are fixed and which are provided to us by the object managers. So, and these access vectors are combinations of security classes and access vector permissions. And the object managers basically associate these classes to particular entities. So that way we're dealing with that way we know with which class of entity we're dealing with and how we can deal with that class of entity, how we can deal with that. So an example is that, for example, the message MSG security class, and the permissions associated with that are sent and received, and that's brace expansion. So the braces expand, and that's basically, it's just a way to represent that that's a set of access vectors permissions that is associated with the message security class. And this access vector as a whole, so as a whole it's message and then the permissions, this access vector is provided to us by the kernel object manager, because it's a kernel object, and the kernel object manager manages kernel objects. So the kernel object manager basically tells us this entity is a message, and these are the permissions that you can use to specify whether how one can operate, or actually in this case I guess how one can interact with a message. Or yeah, that's a good question, whether that's operator or interact. But it's probably interact, because if
if you can receive a message, then someone can send it, and if something sends a message, then it's active. So this is actually an interaction, access vector used in an interaction. So that's a simple access vector, and that's, you can actually look them up as the info. I'm not sure, it's not attribute. Let's just see how as the info. This is a handy tool, by the way, guys. Let's see how you can look up the access vectors. Yeah, here the class. And here it's referring to object classes, but we will call them security classes. So you can actually use C as the info C to see all the security classes. These are all the security classes, and put them to word count. And then, so we have currently on the system 84 security classes. And not all of them are provided by the kernel object manager. As you can see here, we have a security class called dbColumn, which is actually provided by the database object manager as the PostgreSQL. For example, you have the xSelection, which is a security class provided to us by the xServer object manager, which is also a user space object manager. So there's, and for example, the password security class is provided to us by the password object manager, password util. So some of these utils actually are an extension to SE Linux by implementing their own object manager, and that object manager basically maintains a set of objects, and then it basically receives access decision computations from the security server, the SLinux security server in kernel, and then based upon that it enforces access or not. Yeah, it enforces access. But anyways, these are just the classes, but you can also look up the classes and the permissions with their permissions, the access vector permissions. And here you have the so here you have the class, and here you have all the permissions that could be used to govern security to entities of that class. So, but these are this is stuff that is fixed. And this is also what I in the first chapter I think. Yeah, in the first chapter or the second chapter, I noticed that SE Linux is flexible by providing so many access vectors, and this is actually what I was referring to. This is a whole list. We had 84 different object classes, and each of these object classes have their own set of access vector permissions, and we can use those to further specify our rules. And that makes SE Linux so flexible, in combination with the fact that we can actually create those identifiers and associate those identifiers as well to those entities. So you have this combination of three different entities by default, three different identifiers to an entity, the identity, the role, and the type, and then you also have associated to that entity, the security class, and you can use those particular access vector permissions. So you have those access vectors also associated. So the combination of that makes it very flexible and configurable. But anyway, so if you want to look at the particular access vectors available in the system, then run this command and just look them over. And some of them are pretty self-explanatory, but some of them are pretty vague. For example, peer receive from a peer. Files, for example, yeah, files is pretty obvious if you know a little bit about Linux. So you can, for example, where's the file? Can't find file. Right on. But for example, dir, you can append to a dir, you can create a dir, you can't actually execute a dir, by the way. So sometimes you'll find permissions here that don't make sense. And that's not a real problem, because these are just specified in, what you see here is just specified in policy, it's not actual. These aren't actually the access factors, how they are specified in the object manager. It's just the policy representation of it. So if you see, for example, they're executing, you think by yourself, doesn't make sense to execute a dir, then yeah, that could be right, and could actually be that, okay, sure, it's in the list, but you in practice you'll never see an event where a dir is executed. That's just not going to happen. Writing a dir is pretty is perfectly valid. Relabeling is perfectly valid. Link, unlink seems pretty valid. Unlink, actually, those are invalid, I think, because you don't unlink. Unlink is usually means delete, but you don't usually unlink it there. You rm dir it. So here's the actual equivalent for dirs. Files you unlink, you delete, but dirs you don't unlink. I think you just rm dir. And to search a dir means to traverse a dir. So just to traverse a dir, you search it. The search permission allows that. And so there's a bunch of that set attribute get attributes. I think you know what that means. That's for a stat, get stat or set stat or whatever that is. So just look them over. Some of them are pretty darn vague, but you can actually, if you really want to know what it means, then just look up the source code. Look it up in the source code. And there's also a reference list with what most of these access factor permissions mean. But even then, you'll also need to know what these security classes mean. What does it mean, IPC? What is an IPC, inter-process communication? So there's actually, if you really want to have the fullest use S-links to the fullest extent, then you'll want to actually know what all these object security classes mean. What is a socket? What is a FIFO file? What is a file? Now we all know what a file is. What is a node? What is an xcursor? So you might be a kernel hacker and know exactly all those kernel objects. But if you're not an X hacker, then you might wonder by yourself, what the funk is an xcursor? So you could be
it helps if you are familiar with the kernel, because then you'll probably be aware of kernel objects. But SE Linux allows for a user space object manager, so you might have programs with different objects and that you just don't know what it is. And then you'll need to, if you really want to know it, then you need to dig into it. And some of the stuff is really hard to find, especially with regards to some of the vague object managers, database, for example. Well, database drop create, any database administrator might understand that. But some of the stuff is pretty vague. Anyway, so those are provided to us by object managers, and they are actually the core of SE Linux. The core SE Linux attributes, so to speak. You'll always see a combination. You always see an access vector in any event. Any event has an access vector. So yeah, that's a really important concept. Access vectors provided by object managers and aren't mutable, so to speak, or they are just provided to us as is, and we can use them. We can actually use them to define how a particular identifier or entity can operate or interact with it by specifying the permissions. But we can't change the permissions. We can't specify, we can't declare, we can't create permissions, or we can't create objects in policy. It's just provided to us. We can create identifiers, and we can use those, we can associate identifiers to entities, but we can't create access vectors and associate those to entities. That's done to us, for us, by the object manager. Okay, I hope you got that. Okay, so that's with that out of the way, let's get to policy language. So, with regard to identity-based access control, there's a user statement. And that user statement can be used to actually create a identity security identifier, and then associate that with a specified existing role security identifier. So here you actually can create, with this statement, you can actually create a identity security identifier, and then associate that with a role security identifier. That's, I already explained to you that identity identifiers are used to associate as Linux with Linux, but they're also used to associate identities with roles, so that roles can then associate types to identities. And this is how it's done. So this statement expects or has two keywords, at least two keywords. There are more keywords, but I'm not touching on them because those aren't default. Those are additional, optional, and we're just dealing with the bare minimums. So the first keyword is user, and the second keyword is roles. And the user keyword is used to declare, create a identity security identifier. So in this example, I'm creating a new identifier called Joe_you. And I'm assigning these existing role security identifiers, associating those role security identifiers to the Joe_you identity security identifier. So Joe_you is associated with staff_r and sysadmin_r role security identifiers. And these roles need to be existing. This is created. This doesn't need to exist yet. You can create it. This is what it creates. But the roles that you're associating to the identity need to already exist. And how to create those roles? We'll get to that. So here you have the role-based access control statements. And this is the role statement. Declare a role security identifier. So that's basically exactly what I was just referring here. So to declare a role security identifier, you can just use a role statement with, and it expects a single keyword role, and this is how you basically create a new role security identifier: role staff_r and semicolon or something like that. And then the staff_r role is created, and then it can be used here in a user statement. And then we have another role-based access control statement, the role type statement, and this statement actually associates specified existing role security identifier with specified existing type security identifiers. So both the role security identifier as well as the specified type security identifiers need to already exist. And how to actually create a type security identifier, we'll get to that later. Just now know that if you want to use it in a role type statement, which basically associates a role with a set of types, with a single type or a set of types security identifiers, they need to exist. But this is actually what creates the association between a role and one or more types. So it's pretty important statement when it comes to role-based access. And here you have an example. So it expects two keywords, role types, and that's also what the role types statement name implies, I guess. And an example would be role staff_r type staff_t. So now we're associating the staff role to the staff_t type. just telling Asselineau, this is a valid combination. This is these are associated with each other. All right, so let's get on to the next, the role attribute statements. This used to declare role attribute security identifiers. Now, we haven't actually talked about attribute identifiers. We talked about attributes, security attributes, but we haven't actually talked about attribute security identifiers. And this is basically a concept of grouping security identifiers. So it's basically like tagging identifiers. Basically, you can use role attribute security identifiers to group role security identifiers. So basically, the explanation is the following. Role attribute security identifiers are used to associate role security identifiers, enabling us to write policy that applies to groups of role security identifiers rather than individual role security identifiers using the role attribute security identifiers. So basically, it's a way to tag role security identifiers. You can tag them with role attribute security identifiers and then use the role attribute security identifier to write rules that apply to sets of role security identifiers. Sounds like a complicated concept, but it's really, really useful and really used a lot as a Linux, because you have so many types, you can create so many types, and then it's handy to just group types based on properties that they have in common, and then write rules that applies to entities that have common properties the same, so that you don't have to actually write the rules over and over again for each identifier. You can just basically write a rule that applies to all, to a set of particular role security identifiers, and then get it over with. Alright, so the keyword is attribute underscore role, and an example is attribute underscore role and then user role. So you basically here creating a role attribute security identifier, just creating it for subsequent use. And the next statement, role-based statement, access control statement, is the role attribute statement. This actually associates a specified existing role attribute security identifier with specified existing role security identifiers. So for example, earlier on we created a role security identifier, staff underscore R, and we also created a role attribute security identifier, user roles, here. So if we want to, associate the user roles, attribute security identifier with the staff underscore R role security identifier, then we can use this statement. This statement expects a single keyword role attribute, and then here we actually associating the user roles attribute security identifier with the role security identifier of staff staff underscore R. So basically associating, we're basically saying, okay, put the staff underscore R role into the group called user roles. Then we can just write rules that apply to the group user roles rather than all the individual user roles. Alright, next role-based access control statement is the role allow rule. And this rule can be used to determine whether a specified existing role security identifier can manually change to specified existing role security identifier. That's also an important role-based access control rule. So we know that role-based access control is a security model that deals with the security challenge of enabling us to allow a particular entity to change type security identifier. And to do that, we need to allow them to the entity to allow him to change role, because the role is associated with the type. And so if he can change role, then he also has then he automatically has access to the type associated with the target role. So determine whether a specified existing role should be identified. Can manually change to a specified existing role. If that rule is there, then he can he is allowed to manually change to the target role. So the source role is allowed to manually change to the target role. So prerequisite. The target role security identifier must be associated with the entity entity's identity identifier. So if you actually want to allow a entity to change roles manually, then you actually need to associate the target role, the role to which to change, to the identity identifier, and which we did above. Here we actually create a new identity identifier and associate roles to it. So if you want to actually allow staff R to change to sysadmin R, then you need to associate that to the identity in question. So Joe, so a entity that has the Joe U identity can has access to both these roles. And then this rule, the rollout rule, actually allows it to change it. So it's a combination. There are prerequisites. Because if you just allow this without associating the role, then it won't work because, well, the role is not associated to the identity. So that's only half of the deal. The same goes with it. If you only allow this, that doesn't mean that Joe then actually can change from staff R to sysadmin R, because that's not allowed. So it's a combination of rules that allow it. And that's actually not to taunt you or to make it harder for you. That's really actually done for good reason. That it's some of these things require sets of permissions rather than a single one. So anyways, the keyword is allow. And then an example is to allow the staff role to change to the sysadmin role, this rule. And then make sure that the target role is also associated to the identity. Role-based access control, the role transition rule. Instruct SE Linux to automatically role transition from specified existing role security identifier to specified existing role security identifier when a active entity with specified existing role security identifier executes a file with a existing specified security identifier. Sounds pretty complex, but it's an important concept. So let's first get out of the way that automatic role transitions happen on the exec VE syscall. So you can only specify an automatic role transition in your policy if some file is executed. And there's also a prerequisite that the file that's executed that you use for your role transition rule must be located on a file that's not mounted with the no SUID option, because it actually uses that functionality to make that role transition happen. So first we talked about manually changing roles, and this actually goes into automatically transitioning roles. So if you want to actually enforce that, this is actually giving someone discretion to manually change roles, because you allow him to change roles, but he actually needs to use some of the userland user space utilities available to actually change the role. And this actually does it for him, basically instructs SE Linux and says, okay, if a entity with that role executes a file with that type, then transition from the source role to the target specified role. And those roles must exist, of course, in that rule, and the types must exist. And for the entity to be able to transition to the target role, he must also be allowed to manually change role. So this is a prerequisite. So there's a bunch of prerequisites here. The specified existing role security identifier must be allowed to manually change to the specified existing role security identifier with the role allow rule. So that we that this is it, this one. So it must actually be a role allow rule that allows the source role to change to the target role. And then the target role security identifier must be associated with the entity's identity security identifier. Now it's also clear. So yeah, to be able to that simple because we already discussed that. If you want stuff R to be able to sysadmin R, then the sysadmin R role must be associated with the identity of the entity. And the same since the this role transition actually built on the role change, you need to actually have the same prerequisites. Type security identifier associated with role security identifier must be allowed to execute the target file with specified existing type security identifier. So yeah, so the role transition happens on an exact VE. So obviously you must the source must be able the source entity must be able to execute the file because else then the transition cannot happen because the transition happens on the execute. So that's So there are some type enforcement rules that you need to allow the entity to actually execute a file with that type. So the keyword is role transition, and a role transition rule looks like this. So role transition keyword, and then the source role, and then the file to transition on, the type of the type identifier of the file to transition on, and then the target role. So this basically tells us Linux, okay, when a entity with the webadmin underscore r role executes a file with the type identifier of httpd underscore initrc underscore execd, then role transition from webadmin underscore r role to the system underscore r role identifier. And so the identity of this source must also have the system R system underscore R role identifier associated with it. Obviously, because else it's not going to happen. Okay, we're almost there. Let's go on with the type enforcement statements and rules. So the type statement. The type statement enables us to declare create type security identifier. And optionally associated with specified existing type attribute security identifiers and or specified existing alias type security identifiers that are local. So those, if you want to actually associate specified existing type attribute security identifiers and or specified existing alias type security identifiers using the type statement, then those must be local. You can't, as Linux, it can be modular, so you can have different policy modules, but if you, for example, declare a type attribute security identifier in another module, then you can associate it to a type that is declared in another module, with this statement at least. Anyways, we haven't talked yet about types attribute security identifiers, and neither have we talked about type alias security identifiers, so that's not so nice, but okay. Anyways, this statement, this type statement, has two keywords, type and alias. So some examples. So let's say we want to create a type identifier called stuff t, underscore t. This is it. So now we want to actually create a new type called stuff t, and then associate that with a local type attribute called user types. Then you'll use this statement, but then the user types type attribute identifier must also be declared in the same file. So it must be declared on top of where it can't be declared or created in another file, then this statement won't allow you to associate them. Okay, so let's create a stuff d type identifier, and then Elias, the mystaff underscore t type identifier to it. So staff t is also known, aka mystaff t. You could see, you could actually call it aka, also known as mystaff t. And then the same goes. Now you do, so here you're basically associating a type Elias identifier to a type, and here you actually do both the type attribute security identifier as well as a type Elias. So create a type, then make it make mystaff t aka it, Elias it, and then also associate user type to type attribute security identifier to staff t type in one run. Now in practice, we don't use this often, but I don't use Elias as much at all, actually. But it can be some distribution maintainers do actually heavily use Elias. So some do, some don't. Anyways, the second type of enforcement type statement is the attribute statement. And this allows you to actually declare or create a type attribute security identifier. So just like the role underscore attribute statement allows you to declare a role security role attribute security identifier, this allows you to type the attribute statement allows you to declare or create a type attribute security identifier. So same explanation here as with the role attribute security identifiers. Type attribute security identifiers are used to associate type security identifiers, enabling us to write policy that applies to groups of type security identifiers rather than individual type security identifiers using the type attribute security identifiers. So yeah, it's just basically a way of tagging type security identifiers, grouping them. And so this is actually, this creates the tag, so to speak, in that regards. So the attribute statement has a keyword attribute, and an example of how to create the user types type attribute security identifier or tag. So I would call them tag. To create a new tag, use attribute, and then the user underscore types is the tag name, the type attribute security identifier name. All right. So the next type statement is the type attribute statement, and this statement actually associates the specified existing type security specified existing type security identifier with specified existing type attribute security identifier. So this actually, so if you create here the user types type attribute security identifier, then use this statement to actually associate an existing type attribute security identifier to an existing type. So this here, we also talked a little bit about it, about associating type attribute security identifiers to types. But this was only, if you remember, for local type attributes and local Elias types. But this one actually allows you to associate external type attribute security identifiers to local types. So this one always works, but this one only works if the type attribute security identifier is local to the module. So yeah, I usually just fall back to the type Elias of type attribute statement, because well, it always works. So here's some examples. The keyword is type attribute. So type attribute stuff the user types, basically associating the user types type attribute identifier to the staff t security type security identifier. And here you have actually two type attribute security identifiers associated in one run to the staff underscore t type security identifier. So grouping types, grouping roles, grouping types will just group everything to make it easier to write rules that apply to groups of types and roles rather than individual types and roles. Okay, so the type Elias statement associate specified existing type security identifier with specified Elias type security identifiers. So this is basically the same idea as with the type attribute statement, but then for Elias's. And then it's the same with the type statement here, where you can basically use a type statement to associate local existing specified list types and type attributes identifiers to type identifiers. But here you can actually do it for whether the list type is actually remote or local. Although, often cases, the list type no longer even exists. It's just an AKA, just another string known as, or stuff is just known as old stuff. Doesn't actually mean that type, this list type, these other types actually declared anywhere, as far as I know. Again, I'm not using type lists often, but the policy distribution maintainers do actually use this often. All right. So the next statement is the type enforcement permissive statement. This is a pretty new one, and this statement is used to associate specified existing type security identifiers with permissive type security identifiers. And that's a bit inaccurate, this explanation, but I'm sure you might be aware of the permissive mode that SE Linux provides. That's one of the things that many people are familiar with. It's basically, you can actually just basically run setEnforce, and then that puts SE Linux in a permissive mode, in an intrusion detection only mode. By default, SE Linux is actually, could actually be considered an intrusion prevention system. But if you run setEnforce 0, then it actually goes to intrusion detection only mode, which basically just allows everything, whether there are rules to allow it or not, it just allows it. But that's unwieldy, because then you put the whole system in a permissive mode, and oftentimes you just want to put a single entity in permissive mode rather than the whole system. So this permissive statement allows you to actually put a single entity in a permissive mode, in intrusion detection only mode rather than the whole system, by basically using the permissive statement. So the keyword is permissive. And then example is, for example, let's make the staff underscore T type identifier a permissive type security identifier by using this example. So now all the entities with the staff underscore T type are permissive, and the remainder of the system is still enforced. In theory useful, in practice not so. I write policy once in a while, and in practice this is not sufficient, because due to the fact that security is all about interaction operation, so it's always about at least two parties. So you can put this party in permissive mode, but if this party interacts with another party that is in enforcing mode. For example, if an entity with this type sends a message to another active entity with another type, then that's allowed because this type is permissive. Then that other entity might not be able to send an answer back, and then this type will fail because this type was expecting an answer, but it didn't get an answer because the target, the other party in the interaction, wasn't able to send the answer back because that was enforced. So then it fails, and so that for troubleshoot purposes, that's just not handy. So if you're developing policy, then oftentimes you just resort to setEnforce 0, because then everything is permissive, everything is allowed, and then you can use those event logs to determine what's happening, and then you can use that to write your policy. But still, it might be handy. Sometimes it's handy, I guess. All right, on to the next rule. This is actually a type rule, type enforcement rule, the type transition rule. And important to note, type transition rule is a little bit different when it's applied to active entities and passive entities. So here we actually make a decision, distinction between type transition rules for active entities and type transition rules for passive entities. So let's just discuss the type transition rule for active entities, where active entities actually are the source in an operation. In the operation, because, well, the target is also an active entity, because it's yourself. But anyways, that's hypothetical. So let's just say what it means. So basically, you can use that type transition rule to instruct SELinux to automatically type transition from one specified existing type security identifier to specified existing type security identifier. So from one to another, but both the type identifiers must be existing, and you must specify the type identifiers to transition from and to. When an active entity with a specified existing type security identifier executes a file with an existing type security identifier. So when a an active entity runs a file, then you can actually use that to tell SELinux, okay, when this entity runs that file, then transition from that type to a specified other type. But those types must be available, they must exist. And all the prerequisites must be met, which is a shitload of prerequisites, of course. And the automatic process type transitions, or active entity type transitions, happen on the exec VE syscall. And so that must be allowed. So the file that you use to transition on, to type transition on, must be located on a file system that's located, that's mounted with the no SUID, because it's an SUID, the SUID functionality is used to transition. So make sure that sometimes you see that people come to me and they show an AVC denial, and they say, well, I specified a domain type to a active entity type transition, but it's not transitioning, but it doesn't show. And then the first thing I do is, okay, is that partition where that file resides, where that file is located, is that mounted with no SUID? Because it's very hard to troubleshoot. If you don't know this fact, then it's really hard to troubleshoot from just looking at the event logs. So that's why I'm noticing it here. As an administrator, just keep that in mind. If you type transition, make sure that the file to transition on is on a no SUID. It doesn't have no SUID mount option. And the prerequisites, specified existing type security identifier must be allowed to transition to specified existing type security identifier with the allow AV rule, AV access vector rule. And we haven't touched on type enforcement allow access vector rules. But basically, that's basically a simple rule that allows a source type to do something on a target type, and in this case it must be allowed to transition on a target process with a particular specified existing type. The second prerequisite is the target type security identifier must be associated with the entity's role security identifier. That's obvious, of course, because the role must have access to the type. So if you want to type transition, then make sure that the sort of the role of the entity also has access to the target type. Because if that's not happening, then you'll get an SELinux underscore error message and saying, okay, this combination is invalid because the type is not associated with the role. So yeah, associate the role with the type. And then the target type security identifier must be, so that's what we got. And then the source type security identifier must be allowed to execute the target file with specified existing type security identifier. And type security identifier of the to be executed file must be allowed entry point to the target type security identifier using a access vector rule, type enforcement access vector rule. So this is a two-part prerequisite. First, the type, the source type must be able to execute the target type file. And then the target type file must also be an entry point to the target type. So there's basically a rule that says, okay, this files with this type are an entry point to these types. So basically part of a transition rule. So there's actually two actually active entity type transition. There are actually a bunch of rules that you need to actually make that happen. You need to be able to transition to the target type. You need to be able to execute the file to transition on, and then the file to transition on must actually be an entry point to the target type, and all that stuff must be associated, and the role must be allowed to the target type. And if all of those prerequisites are met, then you can actually automatically type transition using the type transition rule for active entities. And the keyword is type transition. And then an example, for example, to type transition from the web admin underscore t type identifier to the init rc underscore t type identifier, you choose a rule on a file with the httpd underscore init rc underscore exec underscore t type. Then you choose a rule like this, and that tells us, okay, when an entity with this type executes a file with that type, then process type transition, so transition the type of the active entity from web admin t to init rct. That's how you process type transition. So this is how you force type changes instead of allowing a active entity to manually type change, which you can also do, but we haven't actually discussed that yet. But you'll use the library functions, the utilities, to manually change. And I think that also actually requires this rule. It's a bit different than role changing and role transitions. The concept of type transitioning and role type changing is a little bit different than role transitioning and role changing. Anyway, so let's get on to the type transition rule for passive entities, so for objects rather than processes. So instruct as a link to automatically type transition from specified existing types query identifier to specified existing types query identifier. When an active entity with a specified existing types query identifier creates a specified file system object in a directory or in directories with a specified existing type security identifier. So here an active entity creates a specified file system object in a directory with a, or in a set of directories with a single specified type security identifier, and then it transitions from one type, the type of the file system object from one type to another. So this happens, this automatic file system object type transition happened when we create syscall. That's when it happened. That's when the actual transition can happen. That's when you can actually, if something creates something, then you can actually consider implementing a type transition rule, a passive, an object type transition rule, so to speak. So the prerequisites are specified existing type security identifier must be allowed to create specified file system file system objects. So the target, if you create a if you want to transition on a file creation, then you must be able to create the file, obviously. With the access factor rule, you can allow that. And must also be allowed to add directory entries to the target directory type security identifier. Because if you can't actually write to the directory, add entries to the directory, then you can't actually create a file system object. Because that usually involves creating the file system object and also adding an entry to the parent directory. Keyword type transition, same as the other type transition rule. And then here, for example, is a rule that tells us okay, when a process or active entity with this type, star underscore t type, creates a file in a directory or in directories with this type, the user home dir t type, then transition from the user home dir t type to the user underscore home t type. And here's another example. Type transition. So tell SE Linux, okay, if a process or active entity with this type, star underscore t type, creates either a file, a dir or a link file in a directory with type user home dir t, then transition files, dirs and link file types from user home dir t to user home t. And here's another example, and this is pretty new functionality. Here you actually tell us Linux, okay, when a process or active entity with the type sysadmin t creates a file in a directory that is type etc t, then transition to from etc t to netconf t, but only if the name of the file is resolve period conf. So if it creates a file in etc dirs with another name, a name other than resolve period conf, then this transition does not apply to it. And then there's some other rules here. This is where I stop. This is then there's some other rules that are really not used often, so I just stopped here. I didn't feel like going on, but there's really one more rule that I should just touch on, and that's the type enforcement access vector rule, so TEAV rule. Type enforcement access vector rule. And this rule basically allow a source or a allow a specified existing type security identifier specified permit access vector permissions on specified objects with specified existing types. And basically this is actually type enforcement, the core of type enforcement, or at least the main thing. This is actually where you tell as Linux, okay, when a active entity with this type does something on something with that type, then allow it. Or don't allow it, but don't log that you don't allow it. Don't print that, or allow it and but print the event anyway. Show me the log of the event anyway. So there's different keywords there. So let's just go get to the keywords. Keywords. It's either allow or don't audit. Or audit allow, and those are actually the main ones. So an example, or a couple of examples. Let's say let's allow a active entity with type softy to send messages, message sent to active entities with type sysadmin. Now, whether that makes sense, I don't know. But this will allow it. So this actually says, okay, an active entity with type stuff T can send messages to sysadmin T. Now that's another one. Let's allow, this is an interaction. Let's create one for an operation. So let's say, let's allow stuff T to create a file with type my file T. And here you have the access vectors in place, or yeah, the access vectors are always in place, but here you have, you actually see the access, these are the access vectors which are provided to us, and these are the identifiers that we create and associate. And this is then the combination. This is what makes it so flexible and configurable. So this is what makes it flexible, and this is what makes it configurable. Now, and then the don't audit rule, you can actually, for example, let's just say, okay, let's, instead of allowing this, let's allow it and then also log it. Make sure that we see when it happens. When stuff D actually creates a file with this type, then also show me it in the log. So audit allow, create audit allow. And that'll allow it and also log it. And then you get granted access vector logs, event logs. This handy if you wanna just make sure you wanna allow something, but you wanna see it when it happens. And then let's just make a final rule using the don't audit statement. Don't audit stuff T shadow T. That's a tangible example file. And then, for example, read and write. So this basically tells SE Linux, okay, when a active entity process with type stuff T tries to read or write files with type shadow T, and this is not shadow R, shadow T, then don't allow it, but don't show me it anyways. Don't show it to me. I don't want to see it when it happens. So there's no log. It won't print any ABC denial. It will just silently deny it. Now, a word of caution, don't use this often, the don't audit rules. Only use them if you well thought it out. Think about it carefully, because if you start silently denying stuff, then troubleshooting becomes hard. And it's a common case in Fedora. Fedora basically, well, it's understandable, but in Fedora, basically, it's a distribution that's used by many people, and it enforces SE Linux by default. And there's this common issue where programmers, where coders, actually don't close file descriptors, so they leave them open, and then SE Linux will print, or will actually, print messages, and they often have to read-write in them, and it doesn't actually allow it, but it just prints it because of the leaked file descriptor. And basically at some point Fedora got so tired of it and said, okay, just don't audit all these rules, because I'm pretty sure that it's about a leaked file descriptor. So just I don't want to see it anymore. But then at some point, of course, you always see that there's some legitimate events where it actually needs read-write, and you decided to just hide them. And then you get issues where some program doesn't work, but it doesn't, and we know that SE Linux blocks it because it works in permissive mode. But there's no ABC denials. And that's because there's this stupid don't audit rule that caught it and said, okay, yeah, I was told to just silently deny it. So then it's hard to troubleshoot. So word of caution, don't use it if you don't have to. But there are cases where you probably want to use it. Be aware that if you use it, make a note for yourself and say, okay, this is where I use it. So if I see some events, or if there are some issues where that might be related, then keep that in mind so that I know where to look. Now, this is basically the core of SE Linux. So in this, really, I think if you really understand everything here, then you have a good base understanding, a solid base understanding of SE Linux. Sure, you can't actually implement it yet because we haven't actually talked about using SE Linux and SE Linux administration yet, or troubleshooting SE Linux yet, or actually writing SE Linux policy yet. We know the policy language, we know how to talk to it, but we haven't actually talked to SE Linux yet. And this is also not a comprehensive list of the policy language. There's more. I forgot to mention the policy, the module statement. And well, there's just some statements that I intentionally left out. And then there's also policy language that relates to optional security models, which we haven't touched on. We only deal with default security models, TE, role-based access control, and IBAC. But there's also optional security modules, and they also have their own policy language that we don't touch on. And then there's also the concept of policy constraints, which basically allow us to add on extra constraints on the existing rules. So basically another layer of an add-on, another complement to the existing rules. So you could, for example, I'll quickly just mention it, but I don't want to make it too hard. For example, you could have a rule that says, okay, allow stuff T to send messages to sysadmin T. But then you could have also, on top of that, additionally, you have a constraint rule and say, yeah, only allow that if staff D operates on a on the same security level as sysadmin. So then there's another extra layer of complexity, which is often not used. It's not really handy in many cases, and that's why I don't touch on it. This is all already complex enough, I think. I don't want to touch on anything that's not strictly important. But this, really, if you want to really seriously know what you're doing, then this is at least what you wanna know and what you wanna understand. And if you don't understand bits of it, then please contact me, and I will try to explain it to you. But of course, make sure that you watch it a couple of times. If you really want to do it, then you have to invest a little bit. And then I'll be willing to help you out. And at this point, if you really know all this stuff, then it becomes much more easier to manage it. But yeah, still, it depends on how it's implemented. In Fedora, Fedora takes advantage of pretty much of the functionality of SE Linux, so that's why the Fedora policy is reasonably complex, but you don't have to implement complex policy. I actually have a policy that has a single type, a single role, and a single identity. Of course, that policy doesn't do anything because you can't actually specify much. You can only use the access factors then, because there's only one identity, one role, and one type. But there are various security classes and various access factor permissions, so you can't actually protect much with that. But it is a very simple policy. It's a few lines, so you are able to do it. Depending on what you want to achieve, policy can be very simple or complex. And since Fedora is a general purpose operating system, it's a pretty complex policy, because you want to actually also facilitate people with complex requirements.
I guess. So yeah, that's it.